Hey everybody, this is Darren from Howl for the Music Scene here at the 2010 Sundance Film Festival here in Park City, Utah. We're here at the premiere for the movie Howl, starring James Franco, John Hamm, Mary Louise Parker, and Jeff Daniels. Let's see who we get in line.
Oh, skinny legions, run outside! Oh, starry-spangled shock of mercy! The eternal war is here! Oh, victory! Forget your underwear! We're free!
With Ginsberg, there was very little film available from the time that we're depicting. Howl is kind of the culmination of Ginsberg's early life and feelings and confusions and all of his friends' lives up to that point. After Howl, he became, you know, a little more recognizable and well-known, and he traveled around, and he became the very confident Ginsberg that everybody knew. He had strong beliefs, and he was, you know, open, but he talked, and he was a very public figure, wasn't shy at all. But before Howl, he was a very confused kid, a teenager, and, you know, young man, you know, man in his early 20s. And because there's no film of that, a lot of people aren't familiar with that, and Rob and Jeffrey and I had to kind of construct that. But with Ginsberg, in these years especially, we had to really craft who that person was, but also have it point to the person that he became.
Did you learn anything about Allen Ginsberg that you didn't know prior to making this film?
I didn't know that he vaguely looked like James Franco. I don't mean you would have mistaken him, but he was a thin, kind of nice-looking guy with a lot of hair, and he wasn't the fat old bald guy that I always saw him as. I was kind of surprised to figure out that he lived longer than almost any of the other sort of beat poets, because all the other beat poets lived such a rough life that they all died of overdoses, basically, pretty early. And Ginsberg lived to be a kind of a ripe old age and have a rather happy life. So I was happy about that.
So what was it like to play this role in the film for you?
Well, I've been a judge and a lawyer for most of my life, so I loved my judge, though. He said great things. He was so thoughtful and interesting in his approach to really trying to honestly figure out whether this thing was obscene or not. Interestingly enough, the judge that I play in this movie, every word in the obscenity trial is true. It's based on the real trial, and it is the real trial. It's just shorter because you can't make a 70,000-hour movie, you know. So they had to condense it. My judge was a Republican. He judged that this poem was not obscene, and he was very smart about it. I mean, he could have gone either way. I do think he seriously considered the alternatives, and he decided that its artistic merit and its intentions far outweighed any danger to anybody that might have happened from reading this poem. But it's about something that's rather important that is happening all the time now, and I rather like knowing you cannot know in advance what everybody's going to think or say or do just because they belong to a particular political party. There are people on the left and people on the right who make their mind up on a case-to-case basis, and I like those people. I didn't really understand it probably when I first read it. You know, I was probably, you know, 15 when I looked at it. It was shocking. I knew it was poetry. I'm not like a genius about too many things or anything, but I can, you know, my own barometer went, that's interesting. Because a lot of stuff when I was a kid that I started looking at, I was immediately interested in the underground film movement when I first came to New York and I was about 18. I didn't know what it was, but I was aware I was being exposed to something that had a real power that I couldn't understand, and you're not necessarily meant to totally understand this. It's an emotional effect that it has on people. I probably don't understand it all that well now.
There's a lot of great stories that come out of this time period. Obviously, this is one of them. Because a lot of things were shifting in this time period. And this case took place in 1957. The beginning of Mad Men was in 1960. So there's not that much time that separates the two. Although the generational shift is significant. And that's, I think, where a lot of the drama comes out of this particular era. Is what's this Eisenhower era versus the Kennedy era? The counterculture versus the sort of conservative white old guy culture. And what's interesting, I think, the more I've worked on things that take place in this era, is that it doesn't really fall down the lines we think it does as we look back on it with 40 years of history on it. There were old white guys like the person I play in the movie who were on the side of, you know, the counterculture and the thing. There was just like, look, we're all Americans.
What about this script really grabbed you and you said you had to do this?
Everybody read a lot of the beats in high school and college, and I was an English major in college, so we had a whole probably semester on the beats. But this script told its story in a very interesting way and chose to represent Ginsberg's sort of process as graphically represented. So there's animation woven into this, and there's archival footage woven into this, and different film stocks, and it's just a very artistic and independent way to tell a story.
I'm with a show called The Music Scene. If you could play any rock star dead or alive, who would it be?
Any rock star dead or alive. I think I'd probably want to be Tom Waits. I want to live that guy's life. I just want to see what he saw in the 70s in Hollywood. I don't know. There's a whole story there. So we'll see.
What was it like working with such a talented cast?
A dream.
They made it very easy. Yeah, I mean, it was, you know, we're used to working with real people, and you know, I like to say that actors are real people too. So it's not that different from what we've been doing before. We're working with real people, getting real moments, but these people are they're such pros that you really don't have to ask very hard to get what you need.
And also, everybody came on the project for the right reasons. Everybody believed in the project. They came on, they read the script, and they said, I'm in. So that was great. Well, certainly issues of free speech, the whole issue of being true to oneself. That's very much how Alan lived his life and expressed himself in his work.
What we tried during the film. Protest against militarism and consumerism and the dehumanization of contemporary culture. I mean, hasn't gotten any better, really, in those respects.
So how did making a film about such an icon affect both of you?
You know, we didn't think of him in that way. And we've made films about people that might be considered icons before in documentary form. I think you have to think of them as real people and find their humanity and find ways to bring forth their humanity. So that's how we approach it.
I'm with a music show. So tell me about choosing a soundtrack for the film and composers and that sort of thing.
Well, we worked with Carter Burwell, who we've worked with before, who's a brilliant film composer. And he wrote a beautifully haunting score. And then we also used some period jazz from the time when Alan wrote the poem. As source music. So we were able to integrate those in a way that I hope feels seamless.
I'm with you in Rockland, where we hug and kiss the United States under our bedsheets. The United States that coughs all night and won't let us sleep. I'm with you in Rockland, where we wake up electrified out of the coma by our own souls' airplanes roaring over the roofs. They've come to drop angelic bombs. The hospital illuminates itself. Imaginary walls collapse. Oh, skinny legions run outside. Oh, starry-spangled shock of mercy. The eternal war is here. Oh, victory! Forget your underwear! We're free! I'm with you in Rockland. In my dreams, you walk dripping from a sea journey on the highway across America, in tears, to the door of my cottage in the western night.